Good evening, I'd like to call the finance meeting of March 4th, March 5th, to order at 6:47. We have a quorum. Maria, that you're over here. I didn't see that outside.
She wants to be facing the camera.
She wants to be on camera. She wants to show off.
Welcome and confirmation of quorum. Okay. Items for review, financials proposed, itemized estimate of expenditures for 2019-2020. Okay? We had, I need a motion to accept a budget to send over to the mayor.
Four questions to Ron.
After we have a motion on the floor, we can have any questions.
I'll still move. In a second.
Okay, wait a minute.
Second.
You made the motion, you seconded it. Is there any discussion?
Question. Ron, I'm not on the phone, but Karen had shared what she received as a phone. And the provision that shows $115,097,089.43. That's this one.
Yep.
Okay. Shows adding in the 421,635 for the teacher pension possibility under the governor's proposal.
Yes.
And the elimination of the security director, the HR benefits, and the finance clerk. The motion that we're sending over to the mayor is for $115,011,141, which is slightly less than the amount in this proposal.
Right.
What else did you eliminate? Roughly $86,000.
Yep.
And my question may be answered in that in the superintendent recommendations, those three positions list salaries. Do those salaries include benefit costs, or are those a separate item from what she has listed in her recommendations?
Okay, so the document you're looking at there is just salary, not with benefits.
All right, so, and your removal of the $193,447.75 is salary and benefits?
I want to make sure I'm looking, because there was another document prepared this morning, which I can pass around if you wanted to update it, but, yeah, included the benefits.
Okay, so where did you eliminate for the other $86,000? Just to get to the 2.8?
It didn't eliminate, when you say the security person, it only cut it in half. The HR benefits, it went down to .6, so I'm not sure what you're looking at.
Well, I'm looking at...
Right.
Her proposal, her staff recommendations included a security coordinator for $80,000.
Right, and that was cut in half, not eliminated. My understanding.
A benefits coordinator for $55,000, and a financial support person for $47,000. If I take all three of those, it's $182,000.
Right, so the financial person was not eliminated, the benefits was cut from a 1.0 to a .6, and the security was cut from a 1.0 to a .5.
If I may ask you, Ron?
Yeah, no, I'm just trying to make sure I understand.
Those positions, the last time we met, those positions were moved over. They were not totally eliminated. And I have an issue with that. What are we going to do with a half-time security director? Is she going to only work 20 hours a week? I don't think we've had an in-depth discussion on that, and what it's going to be, or what. When we left here the other day, I thought we were at 2.8. All-inclusive, prior to the discussion about the teacher's pension. After many long conversations this afternoon, this is my opinion, and I'm going to state my opinion. We don't know if those teachers' pensions are going to have to be paid for by the board. We settled on a budget that was for the best moving the district forward for the next year, school year, and the teachers' pensions was not part of our original discussion until we met yesterday, when I had gotten the information that we were gonna have to pay part of the teacher, that they wanted the board to pay the teacher pension, which is $441,000 and change, and that's included in here.
Not yesterday.
I met with Dr. Robinson yesterday, Karen. I met with Dr. Robinson yesterday. So I was under the impression that we were originally gonna have a 2.8, all-in budget moving over to the mayor tonight, not including the teacher pension.
That was my understanding as well.
And do you have something you'd like to say about that?
I do. I don't agree that we should absorb the responsibility for something that is not solid. You know, it's conjecture. I don't agree until we see hard and fast numbers that we should be promising to incur that kind of debt. Those are my feelings.
Karen?
Well, I think that the planning for the teacher pension is extremely important, because otherwise we're gonna be behind the eight ball if we don't plan for it. And if it comes where we don't need that money for the pensions for this year, we can always use it to the highest, greatest good, but I still think that we need to hardline plan for it, because $500,000 to come up with it like that is very difficult to do once you're mid-cycle. We saw that last year, and I'm not going there again.
The only issue you have with that is, it's all conjecture on the
Bless you.
And for us to plan, us to put that on our side, why does it have to be on our side?
Whose side should it be on?
I was gonna say, where should it be?
It should just be going to the town budget.
It's not a town problem. It's a teacher, we pay the teachers, not the town.
Right, where do we get the money from?
We pay the teachers.
Where do we get the money from, Ben?
We pay the teachers, not the town.
Where do we get the money from, Ben?
The legislation is going to say, the legislation is going to say, and it does say, the Board of Education shall pay it.
Where?
Doesn't matter where we get the money from, we have to account for it, Eric. So what my suggestion is, you account for the $421,000 in your contingency. If it doesn't come about, then you can move it back to where you want to. Because if it does come about and you haven't accounted for it and you have to pay for it, where are you gonna find $421,000 on July 1st?
So you're telling me that we go to the taxpayers and say, we're gonna set aside $500,000 just in case the governor decides to do whatever?
Yes.
And the taxpayers are okay with that?
Well, because if you don't, then you're gonna fund your security person, you're gonna fund your HR person, you're gonna fund your financial person, you're gonna fund all those people. You've already accounted for it. I'm not saying change the amount of money. I'm saying plan for it, plan and not need it, as opposed to not plan for it and need it. Because if you need it and you don't have it, you're royally screwed.
I understand that, Ben, but here's the issue that I have as a sitting chair, is that the chair of the committee and the committee got together and said, let's get it down to a reasonable amount before we walk it across. That $421,000 was not anywhere in any of the discussions that we had had. So that's an add-on, because the 2.8 did not include $421,000.
But it does now.
It only does because that's a question and concern from the mayor's office.
That's not
true.
Wait, one at a time.
Come out, Ben.
One at a time.
Come out, Ben. We do not.
He's talking, just wait a second.
We do not, because the mayor says you should plan for this, have to put that in our budget. That wasn't part of the process, sir. I'm just telling you, that's not part of the process. Now, do I understand planning ahead? 100%, because I live here and I pay taxes. But we sat as a committee, and we worked with what we had.
So let me ask you this, Eric. If the legislation passes, where are you gonna get $421,000?
I cannot tell you, Ben.
Well, then that's the wrong answer.
No, that's the right answer, Ben.
That's the wrong answer, Eric. Because you know the legislation is there. You know the governor is pushing it. You know a large part of the legislature agrees with the legislation. So the likelihood that this is coming in is more probable than it was when Governor Malloy proposed it 2 years ago. like I said, above my pay grade, you're the one who has to find $421,000 after the school year starts, because this budget's not going to get adopted until sometime in June.
Right. I understand.
So you're going to have 2+ weeks to find $421,000 to start the school year with, as opposed to planning for the $421,000 and not needing it and being able to bring people on board that you might want to bring on board, as opposed to having brought people on board and then saying, we got a problem. You're budgeting for the problem that might exist, as opposed to not budgeting for the problem that could exist.
What's the point of having the meetings where these things are hashed out and we come to a consensus if we come to a final meeting and we're thrown basically a curveball? I for one, am not supporting this.
Because the governor decided to throw you the curveball 2 weeks ago.
You don't have a crystal ball, Ben, in all due respect, that tells you exactly what's going to happen in the future. So I'm going predicated on what was discussed among everybody here who's quite invested in the future of our kids in this system. I agree with you 100%.
Okay. Bob?
Ben, when you're talking, I've heard about the legislation too, but can you guys dive into a little bit more about the process behind that, like what you were talking about, what it means, and so forth, just a little bit more?
The governor, 2 years ago, Governor Malloy proposed the boards of ed cover a much larger portion.
Right.
It was a much larger portion of the teacher retirement payment. The theory being that the state pays 100% of the employer side of the teacher retirement payment into the teacher retirement fund, even though the state has no input into the salary negotiation and the contract negotiation for the teachers. So the theory being 2 years ago that if I don't have a say in how much you're paying your teachers, you should pick up part of the teacher retirement. I shouldn't pay 100% of it, I being the state. That never went anywhere, because the way he had structured it is, as Eric knows, and I think Maria, you were there 2 years ago when we did this, it was a 7-figure number. It was a big, big number. It was never going to fly. Lamont has changed the process, and he's looked at it at a different way.
I saw that.
And his number, although a big number for us, is a much smaller number than where he was. But the theory still being the same is I don't get a say in your teacher salaries. Therefore, you should cover some part of it. And if you get to a point where your teacher salary exceeds the state average of the teacher salaries, you actually end up paying more to the teacher retirement. If you happen to be in a distressed municipality, which unfortunately, or fortunately, fortunately we're not, unfortunately for the budget,
we're not.
You pay much less. Mm-hmm. So he's trying to fund the teacher retirement plan, or more soundly fund the teacher retirement plan with other people's money, mainly ours.
Is that where the consolidation part comes in, or is that separate?
That's different. The regionalization, okay. That's a different issue.
Okay. Gotcha.
Right. That's a different issue.
Okay.
Right, so now the teachers pay 7% of their retirement themselves.
Right.
And the state pays 93% of it.
Yep.
For many, many years it was underfunded.
Yep.
And there was not enough money, and there's still not enough money. Yeah. So in order to get his money back, this is what he's proposing. Proposing.
Okay. Proposing.
Let me ask a question, Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
So we're looking at the ECS funding. Superintendent sent out that this town of Stratford may get just a little bit more. But if you look at the ECS funding, it's supposed to come in a certain amount of money, but they back out the teacher's pension, there's still supposed to be money left in there. So why can't they, that gap that I thought I saw, why can't they fill it with that gap?
The town.
Because the ECS funding goes into their coffers and they dole the money back to us. You understand what I'm saying, Ben?
Yeah.
ECS funding, according to the governor, is supposed to be $1 million more, minus the teacher's pension payment, which should be around $420,000, which leaves the town, theoretically, or whoever is doing the numbers, $500,000. So if the town is credited with that $500,000, why are we picking it up when they can set it aside themselves? Do you understand what I'm saying?
In theory, though, I mean, I think our ECS is roughly 22 million, somewhere around there this year, roughly 22 million. In theory, we should get the whole 22 million.
Right,
right.
In theory. I mean, I get your point.
But you understand, it was 21 million last year. It's supposed to be 22 million. That's $1 million. Back out the $400,000+, that leaves about $500,000 left. On the town side, because the money goes to them. Wouldn't that cover us?
But what you're saying is, but you've accounted, I assume, Ron, you've accounted for $22 million in revenue from ECS in your budget.
No, the board really is just an expense side.
Yeah, that's true.
They get the total increase.
Whatever the number is.
Flat.
And they back it out?
Right, they back it out on the other side.
Right. So you understand what I'm saying? If they did it on their side,
yes.
There's a potential for them to potentially have some money where they could handle that instead of placing upon us.
I think it's all going to depend on, one, obviously the legislation passing,
right,
and two,
the
how
votes.
It's written,
right.
How it's written, which I think right now is the board pays the bill.
It does say Board of Ed.
It does say the Board of Education, not the town. So Ron's got to write the check for 421 if it passes.
And it's due December 31st, the way it's written
right
now, believe it or not. It's not due.
Yeah, it's.
And I do believe we need to sit down with the mayor's office and others who we need to sit down with and have a conversation about this, because when she was here the other night, this was never brought up at the table at all.
Actually, it was. As a sidebar, we asked Janet.
I asked Janet the other night.
Yeah. Right, you asked Janet. The mayor was here at the meeting.
I wasn't here for that.
And
meeting.
This was the meeting after the mayor's.
Okay. Yeah, and she did not say at that time anything about us having to include that in our budget. I just feel that once again, and I'm not saying that, I understand what you're saying, Ben. I totally understand you because we all have to plan ahead. But I totally understand how some other people feel, because it's one more thing at the last minute that we have to vote on. So we left the meeting the other night proposing a 2.8% budget to go ahead to the town, over to the mayor, and that's what I would.
Well,
that's a discussion we're having tonight.
The motion that was made is a 2.8% budget that includes $421,635.
That's not what
the motion was.
What was the motion? To send over the budget of
2.8%. There was no caveat. There was no
right.
There was no asterisk star. Anything about a $400,000 payment. We didn't talk about it. There was not an addendum or a friendly rider to go along with that.
No,
it was 2.8 based on what we discussed, period. That's what the motion was.
I understand that. But within that 2.8%, if the 421 comes to be, it's included, there's 421,000 that's accounted for in that 2.8%. The question is, which line items are you going to eliminate? Because you're going to have to write the check.
But that $421,000 was not included in the 2.8.
Right, we didn't discuss that.
So maybe we need to increase our budget by $421,000.
What I'm saying is, at $115,011,000 and change, that's 2.8%. If the 421 passes, we have the money to pay it. You just have to figure out.
We have to make cuts.
Who's not going to get paid?
Right. Madam Chair, can I have a question?
That's why I'm looking at it.
Yes, Eric.
So, Ron, in your, do you have an opinion on this as a COO that you can just add to, since you found this information out yourself, sir? What do you feel as a COO who's been in this position before, dealing with some of this uncertainty, but planning ahead, obviously?
I feel it's unfortunate. I mean, I'll give you the philosophical piece first. It's unfortunate that towns across the state get put in a position at the last minute before the state budget's, you know, put in place. And Ben's right, a year and a half ago or whatever it was the number was huge, and ECS was going to be cut and everything. So it makes planning very, very difficult. I had a discussion this morning with Dr. Robinson, and the discussion was to move forward at 2.80%. And I, you know, think your decision's a difficult one, and I don't know that that there's a right answer. I mean, you're right, if you move ahead without the 421 in there, we're going to have to find a place down the road. And I talked with Dr. Robinson about that, and we've gone out to bid on our health insurance. They came back today. I can't sit here and tell you what it looks like, because it's going to take about a week to get to that point. But I talked with Dr. Robinson about that as a potential place for hopefully some positive gains. We could also eliminate the contingency account completely, which would pick up about $70,000. You know, we typically have about $140,000. I guess, Eric, I don't have an absolute answer.
I get it.
But
I get it.
As I recall, our last meeting, we did not remove the money for those three positions. We just removed the titles that the money went to.
And that's where I'm at a little bit of a loss. You don't have the legacy.
You are at a loss. We did. We put those on the side.
Right. We took the titles to the side, but we didn't take the money away. And if you were, and that's why I was looking at it, and I asked if those salary lines included the benefits, which they don't. If you just take those three positions, if we don't count the SPED positions, which I don't think we put to the side, I don't recall.
I think we did.
Did we put the SPED?
We eliminated.
If we eliminate all the two SPED positions, the security person, the benefits, and the financial support person, that came out to $318,000 just in salary. And when you add in the benefits to it, it probably gets you pretty close to the
421. Magically.
And magic how it works. So that was one of the reasons why I think we pushed the titles to the side but kept the money in the contingency. So sending a 2.8% budget to the mayor, I think we all agreed on that. Mm-hmm. The question is going to be, how are you going to allocate the 421 if it passes?
But we don't need to worry about that tonight.
No.
Because we know what we need. We know the amount of money we need to run the school system next year, and you know.
And you may have $421,000 to hire five people, or you may have $421,000 to make a pension payment. It's the money's there. It's just what you're going to call it once you take it out of contingency. Because I think all the salary money and the benefits money for the new positions were all in contingency, weren't they?
Yes.
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 So they're all isolated, right?
Something new this year.
Right.
So we have a most.
Susan.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Bob.
So with you bringing up that dollar figure of the, was it new?
421.
The 421 and the new positions and so forth, and we have to find that money, then there's going to be finding the money, going back to find that money.
Well, what Ben just said, that if we move the 2.8% budget over, we have some ideas where we can make cuts, because we had talked about that the other day and just moved those positions over, those titles,
right,
of those positions,
right,
over. So we have some idea. But when we get the money back, when we get the budget back, we may see that we need to do something else instead. So we have that chance to look at it once we get it back from the town council, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's
what we do all the time. Allison?
I guess where I'm a little confused is when you say we will have what we need to run the district, but these three positions, we're saying we really don't need them. Does that make sense?
No,
like, if you're saying...
We didn't say we didn't really
no,
need
you know
them.
What I mean,
we
though,
we
like...
have a discussion about them.
Right, but I'm saying if you're saying you're kind of keeping them in without a title, or it could go, we could use that money to do the teacher pension, I feel like you don't really need them. Aside from the teacher pension, let's say that was a non-issue. I feel like then those positions that we're talking about aren't necessary. Does that make sense? If the teacher pension was a non-issue,
yeah,
and we're kind of saying that these three positions are, you know.
We need them.
But do we? That's what I guess I'm confused. Because now I feel like.
Some people feel we need them. Some people feel we don't need them. So we weren't at the point the other night where we were going to totally eliminate them till we had time to have a discussion on them, because we've gotten more information about the security director. We're waiting to get more information about the other two positions. But we thought at the time we would leave them in the budget.
The dollar amount.
The dollar amount in the budget. But that doesn't mean that we have to use them for those positions.
So is there a chance that, that you know that the dollar amount goes over, as Janet and many have proposed, kicks back from the town saying, you know, no, or whatever, and then we're left to look for...
Yep.
Absolutely. And that's what, and Bob, that happens more often than not.
Right.
They give us a different amount than we asked for.
Right.
And then we have to go back and through the budget and make some serious cuts.
We could send 2.8 and 2.5.
That is predicated
right.
on the superintendent right. and the COO making the cuts and then bringing it back.
Right. So them making the cuts, not us making the
right.
cuts.
We don't make the cuts. They will make the cuts, however this goes, and then they'll come back and ask us how we feel about it.
Vinny?
Yeah, well, Alice and Jen, thank you. Like for the security officer, I didn't want to vote on it until I saw a job description.
Right.
So that's why I think that was pushed aside. And Eric got me a similar job description from Milford.
Right.
So now we know what we're voting on. And I think we wanted to do that with the other positions. So it's not that we didn't need them. We weren't sure whether we needed them. You know, what is this security officer going to do, kind of thing.
Right, and which is, you know, why we, I feel like we should really be talking to the, do we talk about talking to the chief of police?
That was all
right,
on
that
list.
Right,
that was all
right. So I'm saying a vote tonight, though, would be saying we're doing that without doing any of that, though.
Right.
No, you're not voting for those positions. You're voting
right.
for the total dollar amount.
You're voting for the total.
That's what you're voting for.
Because Dr. Robinson can come back to us next week and say, we can't fund the security, we can't fund those other two because we need three more special ed teachers because
mm-hmm.
we've gotten so many new kids this week and we know that we're going to be getting, so we have to use that money for special ed. Or we have to use that money for something else we were talking about. But we just need to make sure that the money is there.
Why did you say that?
Okay? We just need to make sure the money is there.
She's
don't
having Miller back. She's not looking it out of the coffin.
So.
But that
well,
is
well, there's your 421,000
million. That sounds much better.
421,000.
Now there's to pay them.
Wow.
Our budget gets
so,
close to that.
So understand that we vote on a total dollar amount, and then the superintendent and her staff will go through and back and make sure that they have. And Susan is right.
Mm-hmm.
We have run into cases where things have happened in the school district where we have to make those adjustments. For special ed or DCF.
Transportation.
Transportation.
Mm-hmm.
I've had, you know, I walk. Yes, there is
yes.
a very dynamic situation that Ron deals with on a daily basis. And we're required to do that.
Vinny?
Yeah. Now, my concern is something that Bob brought up just now, and that is. If we're fairly certain that 2.8 is going to be acceptable or something close to that, that's great. But if the town sends it back and says more has to be cut, and then the governor and the legislature puts in for the pension payment, then we're behind the eight ball not only for the pension payment, but for finding money for whatever cuts the town has. So if we did put in the money for the potential pension payment, does that give us a little more flexibility to negotiate? I don't know.
My personal opinion, that if that happens, Vinny, we would sit down and have a really heart-to-heart talk with the mayor's office and the other side, because as Eric said, if we're getting all that ECS money, there's no reason why they can't help us pay that bill. I'm just thinking that if we, that's my opinion, they can help us pay the bill. They can pay the bill.
Well, Ron, what do you think about that question that he posed?
They give us the ECS money.
About Vinny's question?
Yeah.
You know, there's just a lot of speculation. I mean, we're sitting here on March 5th, and we're trying to guess where we're going to be on June 30th.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess you got to vote your conscience, so to speak, and hope that it doesn't go up. I mean, you know, because finding money is never easy, and these we're talking big numbers for sure. $421,000.
That pension fund that they say 421,635 that can go up.
Well,
Could it go up? If they, the legislation or the governor decides to change the math on how they're calculating, yeah. It's going up the second, I mean, he had proposed a biennial budget and it goes up the second year from 421 to, yeah. So, I mean, so of course you could, I mean, you know, last year it went away, right?
Yes, last year it went away.
But ECS changed.
Did we panic last year about it? No, we didn't. Did we discuss it last year? No.
So, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Bob.
Mrs. Lance. So when you had the conversation with Janet, her feeling was push, move forward with the, when you had the conversation.
My conversation I had with her yesterday.
Yeah.
She only found out yesterday.
I only found out from a phone call, and I came down here yesterday afternoon, and I told her what I had heard. We called the mayor. The mayor was not available to talk to us.
Okay.
I talked to Janet at 5:30 tonight, and her proposal would be to go to 2.8 budget, which includes the $421,635 for the pension fund.
Which includes it?
Which includes it would be the 2.8.
Okay.
So really and truly, we're looking at $421,000 less in the budget than what we had decided the other day. Correct?
Yes.
Ben, correct?
Yeah, it gives you an effective increase of 2.42.
Yeah.
Right.
If you take the 421 out.
Right. So mm-hmm. we had talked about a 2.8 budget to send over to the mayor anyway.
Okay. Because if you send over a 2.8 plus the 421,
right,
it's 3.1. It's 3.2, which she's going to cut to 2.8.
So suppose we send it over to 2.8, and I mean, it's just speculation. Mm-hmm. I mean, all of it is just obvious speculation.
It's all speculation.
Yeah, right. And comes back and says, no, we want 2.5, 2.4. Isn't what?
That's the possibility they can do it. Then we have to figure it out.
Then not.
The superintendent
have to figure it out. And then the board has
right.
to, the finance
right.
committee has to send it to the board with a favorable recommendation.
Which is no different than what we've done, or any of us have done, on any committee that we've served with over the last 20 years I've been with the Board of Ed. You will now do this consistently. The remaining board members and the new ones coming on, you will continuously do this because that's what continuously happens. We don't always get our asking number going across the street.
Usually it's a cut.
It's usually a cut, and it's up to the superintendents and their staff to figure it out, and the board votes. So it is a very contentious or problematic position that it puts us in, but that's what happens, and that's why you have the COO who sits here and says, I can do this, well, we can do this, this, and that, we cannot do this, and the superintendent presents it to us, and that's how it works.
The 115,011,141 is 2.8. We all agreed on 2.8.
Correct.
At the last meeting, so that's what we're going to send over. I think we've, to some extent, been somewhat saying the same thing differently. That 115 million includes $421,000 should the legislation pass, and there are some positions that won't get hired. Should the legislation not pass, there's still $421,000 in the budget that's just not going to be used. The check's not going to be written to the state of Connecticut. It's going to be written to somebody else.
There would be nothing if we sent this to the town like this that said if it doesn't pass, they're only going to give us 2.42, though, correct?
Yeah. Once the council approves 2.8 and the mayor signs it, it's 2.8.
Then we decide where the money goes.
Right. Then you'll decide how you want to spend the 421 if the pension bill doesn't pass.
But this budget that we decided on the other night of 2.8 for 115 million. The amount we talked about did not include the $421,000. It included that amount of money to run the school system as we deemed necessary as of our meeting last Thursday night. So you can look at this two ways. It's a catch-22. Mm-hmm. If we include the 421 in it, the only thing to our advantage is if they throw it away and they don't do it and we already have our 2.8, then we get the whole 115 million. We don't lose anything. If we don't include it in there and they cut it, we're going to lose out on that too. But that's just something that everybody has to vote with their heart, what they think is the best thing for the district. Because right now,
If we had voted last week, we wouldn't even be talking about this $421,000. So, there's a motion on the table right now. Could you read your motion? Wait, excuse me.
She asked for a few minutes.
We took a few minutes?
She's asking for a recess.
No, but I still want you to hear the motion.
Okay.
We take a recess, but we can have a motion. Can we take a recess when we have a motion on the floor, Teresa?
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, the motion was to accept and send to the mayor's office the itemized estimate of expenditures for fiscal year 2019-2020 in the amount of $115,011,141, 2.8% increase over last fiscal year.
That is the motion on the floor, and we had a second by Vinnie. Now I'd like to call a 10-minute recess.
You call it.
At 7:23 to come back at 7:35.
Okay.
Okay?
For a recess.
Okay, I'd like to call the meeting back to order at 7:35. We have a motion on the floor, and it's been seconded. We've had a discussion. Anybody else that I think that I'm going to talk about?
Can I guess just add to the discussion or question, if we go ahead with the 2.8%, do we have to, when we vote, say would if we wanted to set that money aside or not?
No.
No,
we don't have to.
No, we're not.
We're specifically not saying that.
Okay, just, but, so it could go.
It's going to be up to you, should the legislation pass or should it not pass?
And when they look at the budget, they'll come back and tell us what it includes.
Okay.
I'm going to take a roll call vote. I'm going to start with Mr. DiLorenzo. I'm going to start with Mrs. Paterla.
Yes.
Mr. Fagella?
Yes.
Mrs. Rodia?
Yes.
Mr. Proto?
Yes.
Not you. Mr. DiLorenzo?
I'm going to go no.
Mrs. DelBene?
Yes.
Mr. Lazaro?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. The motion carries 6-1. Thank you.
All right, let's move on to CIP and...
The next issue is to look at our CIP with the...
7-1.
Oh, yeah.
7-1, I'm sorry.
Yes, 7-1.
I'm used to the other... Can't count. That's where my mind is. Okay, when we met last week, we prioritized the CIP, and we got the list from Dr. Robinson, the top 10.
I didn't get that. Did you get your top 10?
Top 10?
Okay, I need a motion.
Make note of that this is the first time I think we're sending over a top 10 list in your motion.
It's like David Letterman.
Yes.
That was really good.
Your top 10?
You want me to read them? I need a motion, please.
I make a motion to accept and send to the mayor's office for the town of Stratford, the CIP, Capital Improvement Plan, CEP, Capital Equipment Plan, five-year plan, 2020 through 2024, including the top priority list for 2020, fiscal year 2020 through 24.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to accept the CIP. Any discussion?
I'd just like to say publicly thank you to Board Member Karen Rodia for taking on a tremendous
task
of going through CIP years all the way back to now to make clear, concise information that hopefully going forward will set boards of education subsequently on the right path for having that communication. So I'd like to thank you for that. That was a yeoman's task. Thank you.
And I'd like to make a comment too. We, at our liaison meeting, we asked that a board member or members could be on the, included in the meeting between the mayor and the council and the Board of Ed to discuss the capital budget plans for capital improvement plans and equipment plan as they go forward this year. We've never been at the table before, but we think it's very important that we have a voice in that too. So with that being said, anybody else? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried, 7-0. Thank you.
8-0.
8-0. Word of math.
Okay, and the next item on the agenda is to take the Durham Transportation contract off of the table so we can discuss it.
Oh, okay. All right, I'll make a motion to remove the Durham Transportation contract off the table, originally tabled in the January 28th, 2019 Board of Education meeting.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Does this have to be a non-meeting?
Susan.
Is it a contract?
Teresa. It doesn't have to come off the table here. It's just it's no action. It's information. It'll have to come off the table at the special board meeting.
Oh, so we can still talk about it here?
Yes.
Okay.
It's just discussion.
Do we withdraw your motion?
I made it. I withdraw the motion.
Okay. All right. Ron?
So back in December, we started I sent the original contract out that was put forth by Durham Bus Company, and at that time, I was asked to send it back to Floyd Dugas, our attorney, to see if there was any language changes or any other thoughts that he had. He came back and asked for 3 dates to be changed, and the dates were where they stated 30-day notice, he wanted a 90-day notice. So I went back to Durham Bus Company and I said, can we change? It was items 2A, 2B, and item 4 to 90 days. They came back and said, that's fine, and they changed the language. And it basically has to do with notice periods. So the language was reviewed by our attorney, the modifications were made, and so now we have the contract in front of us. The motion is calling for approval of a 4-year contract, which started retroactive last July, the one that we're in. And just for reification, the reason there was a delay is we had needed to see when we cut all the buses how many we were going to end up with, so that they could go back and determine what their quote was going to be to us around the renewal, because there was a clause in there that said if we dropped more than 5% of the buses, we would negotiate in good faith. They came back and gave us 2 proposals, 12.89% and 9.76%. And the reason the first one's lower, or the second option is lower in the first year, because it's a little bit higher in the out years. However, the second option, when we went back and forth on it, does save us $104,000 over the first option. So the recommendation is take option 2 and renew it for the contract for what would in essence be 3.5 years at this point. So we can have a discussion here, and then the full board needs to make a decision and a motion on approval of the contract if that's the direction we want to go in.
Anybody have any questions? Seeing none, I need a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried, 8-0. Thank you.